Where were you born?
Well,
where
I was born and raised in my younger years in Portsmouth, New Hampshire, in New England, as you know. And if I stray too far and tell you, I was just going to tell you a very unusual boyhood, you might say, coming from that area. Back when I was a boy, there was no Sunday movies. Town cop knew who was allowed to play ball on Sunday and who wasn't. And if he caught me over in the field with some of my buddies, he'd run me right on home. I'd get the devil. Pretty much of a Puritan type living back there that I was raised in. The result is I don't know how to dance very well and don't know much about cards because we didn't have that in my home.
Was it a safe, kind of secure era? You know what I mean? Did you feel safe as a kid growing up?
Oh, yes. No danger whatsoever. Nothing to worry about.
Were you the kind of kid that liked school?
Yes, I liked it. I strived to do as best I could and always got pretty good grades, above average, I'd say. And yes, I did like school.
You know, when you walk into a room full of little kids in school, and they're all the noise and everything, and you've got the smart kid, the loud kid, the quiet kid, the intelligent kid, you know, all the personalities. If we'd walked into your school classroom, which kid were you?
Quiet, probably sitting toward the rear to not be center of attraction or noticeable. Shy, is probably sitting there at the back of the room, and but attentive. I didn't play around like a lot of kids do. I was interested in learning.
Was it an outdoor childhood? You know, sports and running around and all that kind of thing?
Pretty much so. I was always young with the group I was in. I guess the small school had too many students in the lower grades, and I was actually skipped past the second grade. Which I didn't appreciate as I got older because I was always in with older fellows and I was small to begin with, and it put me at a disadvantage with sports. I always loved to play sports and played a lot of sandlot sports, but like for instance in high school, I was still trying to get out of knickers into long pants when there were fellows in high school. Now this was in Philadelphia, about the eighth grade of school we moved to Philadelphia. And I was in a big high school there, and some of the men there, of course, they were a couple of 3 years older than me because of having skipped second grade and started school young. And they were sporting mustaches and everything, and I'd say I was still trying to get in the long pants. And I didn't have much of a chance at high school sports, and all, but I played a lot of sandlot sports, all sports.
Did the Depression affect your family?
Yes, it did. My dad only went to 8th grade of school, got in the World War I right at the end of it, and so he didn't have much of an education. I was born while he was in the Marine Corps at Portsmouth, New Hampshire, this Navy Yard there. And he wound up with four children, my being the oldest, and to support, and work was hard to get. I was born in 1921, and he wound up driving a truck and made an honest living, but he wasn't equipped for much more, and there weren't that many jobs around. So yes, it was in that era of bad times, you might say, and we always had food and clothing, but sometimes it was hand-me-downs. And I learned to be frugal myself because we never had that much money. It was a type of a childhood where if I went out and earned some money shoveling snow or doing things, I'd go home and put whatever I earned on the table there so my mother could buy a loaf of bread or whatever. That's the kind of a... So it was, yes, in answer to your question, it was a period of depression. And
you know, even though it was the Depression and in difficult times, when you look back on your childhood, did you like your childhood?
Yes, I did.
Why was that?
I had good parents that taught me right from wrong and took me to church. I was going to say made me go to church. There's probably heels in New Hampshire when I went to church morning, noon, and night, you might say. I was a Methodist, and most of the children I grew up with were Catholic, and I was Methodist, but was very tolerant people back there, and we all got along. And but I tell people there's probably still heel marks in the alley going leading up to the church there between hedges where I was taken to church there. I didn't maybe not want to go, but however, I received a good training in my boyhood. Even though my dad was just a truck driver, he made me hold my fork right and made me taught me everything I should know in the way of table manners and discipline with my sister and my mother, how to treat them properly and so forth. And I came away with a good training. And from what I learned at home, plus in church and Sunday school, I started knew right from wrong. And I wasn't the type of a child to give my parents a lot of problems and worries. I more or less played life by the books.
Were you drafted or did you enlist?
No, I enlisted. I never even signed up at a draft board. Somebody told me about it later years after I retired from the service. I'm a retiree, a military retiree, and somebody brought up the fact of where my selective service board was, and I couldn't tell them, and said, you'll never get in trouble. You're supposed to be enrolled somewhere. And I did go to the draft board, I think, back in Philadelphia at one time, and I told them my experiences and how long I was in and everything, they just kind of said, forget about it.
Why did you enlist?
I enlisted because I thought it was my duty. I was at the right age. I was 20, early 20s, and Pearl Harbor had occurred, and the country was at war, and I thought it was my duty to help my country as best I could.
Well, take us through that first time getting in the service and the training that you went through, and what happened?
All right, I was in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, as I say, where I enlisted. I wanted to be a Marine because my father had been in the Marine Corps when I was born, and he was like Marines. Once you're a Marine, they say you're always a Marine. Well, anyway. I went down to the custom house in Philadelphia and up to the third floor to enlist in the Marine Corps in February. Of course, to Pearl Harbor's in December. Early part of February, I went to enlist. Figured it was my duty, and I wanted to serve my country. And the Marine Corps wouldn't take me because my teeth didn't meet right in the front. I had an overbite. And lo and behold, I couldn't get in the Marine Corps. And I thought, how am I going to go home and tell Dad I couldn't be in the Marine Corps? So I went down the next floor down, and it happened to be the Navy was down there, and I got the same doctors. The Navy doesn't have their own, well, the Marine Corps don't have their own doctors, but it's the same battery of doctors I ran into, same thing. So I went down the first floor, and I thought, boy, if I don't get in the Army, I guess I'll just be the best Boy Scout I could ever be. Of course, the Army waited for me with open arms, and I went in. But later on, my dad, after what I achieved in the Air Force or the Air Corps at that time, my dad thought pretty much about the Air Corps as he did the Marines. Going along with your question, then, unless if I'm straying too far, let me know. I enlisted, and I really hadn't talked. I don't remember whether I talked it over with my mother and father much before I did. Come home and told him I was in. I was sent to Camp Lee, Virginia, and didn't do much there except we did have some counseling, and we were able to tell the Army what we wanted to do. I didn't know what I wanted to be in, so out of the clear blue sky, I said, want to be a pilot. And I'd only had a high school education, and they had dropped their requirements at that time from, say, 2 years of college to be an aviation cadet to accepting me as a high school graduate. Of course, the physical and the mental tests were pretty tough, and I was astounded that I was able to get through both of them when I saw much bigger men than me, and college people in college couldn't make it. But I was lucky and made it, and accepted to go to the aviation cadet school.
Had you ever been in an airplane?
One time when I was a very young man, or a very young boy, I should say, probably about 7 or 8, my father was, we were still living in New Hampshire then, rather than Pennsylvania. I was about the 8th grade and moved there, but my father was driving for a Texaco oil company then, driving a gas truck, and a small field there where town I was born in, there was a fellow probably barnstorming, I think they called it in those old days, had an old airplane and give people rides for a small amount. And because my dad had delivered gas to him for him, he asked my father if he wanted to take a ride. Well, he did. And when they got down, my father said that, and the pilot said that I looked so disappointed that I couldn't go too, that they gave me a ride. My father let me go up in that airplane, and what type it was, I don't know, but it had to be an old type airplane. That was my first ride.
Do you remember, was it a thrill to go up in
the... Yeah, it was really a thrill. No, I wasn't like some people that I know that thought about flying all through their youth and so forth, fell in love with the air. It didn't interest me that much. I was too much interested in sports and things. However, that ride was very I was very enthusiastic over that ride. And as I say, when I was given an option after I got into reception down there at Camp Lee, Virginia, and they asked me what I'd like to do, right away I said, I want to be a pilot.
Well, then you got in the cadet program. Where did it go from there?
Well, I got the cadet program, and I circumstances were such that they couldn't send me right away to a flying school. So I went to Biloxi, Mississippi, kind of a boot camp, I guess you'd call it. And it got to be real drudgery there. There was nothing to do, drilling with wooden guns and so forth, and the details, working right along prisoners. I wasn't a prisoner, but be prisoners out there with the guards, and we'd be digging ditches the same as they would be. So anyway, a call. Biloxi was a big base, a lot of personnel there. It was a mechanic school at that time. And a call came out for volunteers for gunners, tail gunners, or gunnery school. So I grabbed it, and another fellow and I went down to sign up for it. And we were interviewed by the base commander, asking us if we knew what we were doing, you know, what kind of a dangerous position we were choosing to be a tail gunner, like Dick was. But anyway, I was accepted, and I went to Panama City, Florida, and went through gunnery school. And
you know, let me ask you a question. Why were you so anxious to get into it and take a dangerous position like that?
Well, it was my nature, I guess, to do something important. I wanted to do something that out of the ordinary, to achieve something, maybe for to be proud, to make my parents proud, or make myself proud, my own ego. And I went to gunnery school, and still the aviation cadet program hadn't materialized. I hadn't been called, and I was down in Florida there, and I was in an outfit as a tail gunner that was getting ready to go overseas. And I had my bags packed and everything to go overseas with this outfit somewhere in the Pacific. But finally my cadet appointment came through. So there were three of us, and one of them had an old car, and we hopped in it, and we were to report to Santa Ana, California for pre-flight school. We went there, and in that car we had quite an experience going across country, but made it out there. And finally went to pilot school up in California, basic or primary course. And didn't get through that, unfortunately. The biggest and worst disappointment I had in my life, it was a civilian school, and the instructor had about 6 students, sold me first, was doing great, and we lost a student, didn't pull out a spin. So the next day, a second lieutenant came in there and gave us all progress checks. My instructor said, "Now, don't be squeamish because you lost a student. He's going to be looking for that. So be very emphatic in your stalls and spins and aerobatics." Well, I did that, The next morning, I met the board for being too dangerous and reckless. That was the end of the pilot training. And anyway, there's a little story with that, though. They washed 75% of the class out, and I truly believe until even today that it was a personnel problem. There were B-17s and B-24s going overseas, and like in, when you're a kid, everybody wants to be the pitcher on the club or the quarterback of the football team. Everybody wants to be a pilot. So they needed a bombardier and navigator downstairs, and where are they going to get them real quick? They washed out 75% of the class, and we already had a smattering of airmanship and everything, so we were the ideal ones. We got back to Santa Ana and lined us up, and you're going to bombardier school, navigator, bombardier, navigator. And so I became a bombardier. And I always kind of thankful for that. I'm sorry I didn't get through pilot school, but I became a good bombardier. And
talk about the training, how they take a kid and turn him into a bombardier.
Bombardier. All right, well, we were kids, as you say, and it was a very disciplined school on the honor system, just like West Point and Annapolis on the honor system. Even us kids in bombardier school, no cheating or nothing like that. And anyway, I had a master sergeant for an instructor, and we fly on training. We had trainers in a big hangar, tall. I'm trying to liken it to almost look like a scaffold on the outside of a building. It was a tall thing that you climbed up in, had a bomb sight on it, and you operated the bomb sight and ran against a target on the ground on the other side of the hangar. And that was the ground training, plus a lot of associated subjects for like weather, code. We had to learn to take code, and many subjects like that as far as general aircraft knowledge. But then came the flying phase, and we'd fly, and they'd take up two cadets at a time, and we'd drop bombs out in the, this was in New Mexico, Albuquerque, New Mexico. We had a range out there. We'd drop bombs, and we had to maintain a certain circular error accuracy as far as our bombed circular targets with rings in there, and you had to, we had to, at the time I graduated, we had to achieve an accuracy of 230 feet from the shack, they call it, in the middle of the target area. And had the aerial, had this training as far as the air, and then if we achieved the right results and graduated, we graduated as a second lieutenant. Yeah. We went from there, from New Mexico, Kirtland Field, Albuquerque, New Mexico. The bombardiers went to different places for different groups, different assignments, but I was sent to Pyote, Texas, and it was called Rattlesnake Army Air Base. It was in the panhandle of Texas, and there were signs around warning you not to put your hands near bushes or anything, because there were a lot of rattlesnakes down there. And there was the formation, you might say, of the crew I wound up on. We lived in tents down there, and I reported in and went to a certain tent, and there I met the man who was to be my pilot. And the crew was built around, with no disrespect to the gunners, the crew was built around the pilot and the bombardier. That was the main essence of the crew, because your mission was bombing. And I met a pilot, and as soon as I got the tent there to meet him, shook out my hand. I'm still a young boy. I'd never been away from home before. I got the service, even overnight, hardly. And so he told me, he informed me that he was a West Pointer. Well, I graduated West Point. I didn't know whether I was supposed to say Allah or what. And anyway, I got through that, and we formed the crew then around us. I don't think we even picked up gunners there. We went from there, he and I went to Dalhart, Texas, and for our first B-17 training. It was in three phases, and we started there and picked up gunners and an engineer and so forth.
Remember when you first got in the B-17 or first saw it, or what your impressions were? It was a big plane.
A big plane, yeah, a big plane, and I was so proud that I was going to be a bombardier and something like that, that the government trusted me to for that kind of a job position. I was very, very proud. And the first time I flew, the bombardier flew way up in the nose, you know, with plexiglass. You were out there almost sitting out there away from the airplane, something like the ball turret down below. But anyway, I had vision, you know, that vision with a plexiglass all around me, 180 degrees. And the first time I flew, I just couldn't imagine that nobody, a fellow like nobody like myself, just a high school graduate, and already at that young age, I was assigned to a position of such importance. So I was very proud. I remember the first night mission, looking down there at small towns and helping the navigator, telling them where we were. I always flew with a map on my knees rather than just sitting there daydreaming. I always helped the navigator. We get along real good. And if I could tell them that we just passed over Odessa or someplace at a certain time, I'd make a notation in my chart. And I was always a good aide to my navigator. I did what they call pilotage. Anyway, and I became good at that, I think. But anyway, one time we took off from Delhar, Texas, and we went to land there one night. The pilot hadn't had much nighttime, and so many towns in the Panhandle of Texas are just small towns. The lights on either side of the street looked like a runway, and the pilot was actually was getting the configuration to land. And so I had to tell him, hey, this isn't the runway, this is the main street of Delhar, Texas here. So, he wouldn't have actually landed there, but he was preparing to. He mistook the lights. It looked like a runway. So I was kind of proud of myself for kind of straightening that out. But anyway, we come back there one time, we couldn't get the gear down. The gear wouldn't operate properly.
The landing gear.
We couldn't get it all the way down. One was about two-thirds of the way stuck up, and one we couldn't get down at all. So, we did everything we could, emergency-wise, with our training to get it down, but it wouldn't go. We couldn't even crank it down. So we were told to go to Tinker Field, Oklahoma City, which was a big depot, maintenance-wise, and they said since we were going to have to crash land anyway, we might as well go there to Tinker Field, and where they had all the capability of repairing the airplane. So we got there, and we had an instructor pilot who had already been over to England and come back and was an instructor. So he was giving our pilot an instrument check. Well, good thing we had him aboard. That gave us a lot of insurance. He had some experience. But anyway, the tower told us, we get up there at Tinker Field, and the tower said there's Boeing representatives up here in the tower, and we want to get a look at your gear to see if we can determine what might be wrong. So they were telling the pilot, now, don't be afraid to get down too low. We want to see the gear. And they kept stressing, now, get down low enough so we can see the gear. Well, this instructor was really taking us all in. He was going to give me a show. Well, we came in low, and they said, all right, bring it around again and bring it up higher so we can see it. Oh, he would get a big kick out of this. And we were given he gave us the option of.
So he was so low, they couldn't see it.
Yeah, they couldn't see it.
The gear.
But he was getting a big kick out of this because he had a little time in the airplane and knew what he was doing, but he got a little charge out of this. But anyway, I should say before that happened, or as that happened, he gave us the option of the rest of the crew of bailing out or crash landing with the airplane. And we elected to stay in, and he brought in very nicely on the grass and made a belly landing, and everybody got out fine. But that was kind of a scary type thing. It could have been drastic. And
where did they put everybody in the radio room? Did you go in the radio room when you crash landed?
Yes, we did.
Was it a big bump when you hit?
No, it wasn't too bad. It was, he just kind of slid in there. He made a good landing. There was a bump naturally, but it wasn't anything that we weren't thrown about or nothing like that. But that was about the only thing that happened in training that there was any consequence. We went through training real well. Finally went to Grand Isle, Nebraska, which was where we picked up an airplane, a new airplane, and flew the northern route through Presque Isle, Maine, and Newfoundland, Iceland, and over the northern route into Scotland, then down to our base.
That's such a long journey and over so much water.
Yeah.
What do you remember about that?
A little bit scary, realizing you're over water all that time, over land you knew you could bail out and probably hit the ground properly and survive it. But a little bit scary flying over that much water. Everybody on the crew, it was our first experience of flying over water and just a distance like that. And it was great elation when we saw the Irish coast, I guess we saw first, coming in over there, and great elation. Probably elated like coming back from mission and still being alive. We wound up, because I say we landed in Scotland, and we flew down to our base, which was about 30 miles north of London, a little town called Nuthampstead. Prior to our being there, there'd been a P-38 fighter squadron based in there, but they moved them out of there, and we took over the base, Station 131. And it didn't have a name, really. It was just Station 131 at Nuthampstead, England. It was unlike any of our bases in the sense that there were areas for each aircraft where they were parked, and runways a little bit different. Of course, we were assigned a Nissen hut to live in. You know what a Nissen hut is, I assume you've heard that expression. Three crews were in one Nissen hut, three crews of officers, that is, and the enlisted men lived in another area, probably in a hut of the same size. We had a stove in there, and we were, before we went over each crew, we were given a case of K rations. And they became very important. There was good food in there. There was cans of scrambled eggs and bacon and cheese and there was a little candy in there and whatnot. They became so important, each crew had one. To take over, flew over into the airplane. They became so important. We had to kind of guard them at night in the huts there. People would steal them. And anyway, that was just kind of a funny sidelight. But we lived in the Nissen huts, and everything went along fine.
Did the training continue even when you got over there?
When we got over there, if you were lucky, you flew a few training missions. I say you were lucky. Everybody didn't get the same amount of training. What happened was the last base for our training was at Rapid City, South Dakota. And we formed up with the group when they had been together quite a while. And we weren't, and then we joined them. And as I say, I had earlier in my story, I said we had a West Point pilot. There were six of them that joined the group. I and our crew had one of them. When we joined the original group up there in Rapid City, they were getting ready to go overseas, and we joined them. We were newcomers as far as they were concerned. We were, you might say, a charter member of that group as far as going overseas with them, but we were kind of new to them up there. And I think there was a feeling that amongst the older crews up there that the West Point pilots were going to take over because of them being West Pointers and so forth. They'd be the top crews and the leaders, and they kind of shut us out. And you could see their resentment and kind of keeping you in the background. Because we went over there as a group, and we joined two other groups that became a wing. The other two groups had been over there for quite some time. Now this was in September of 43 when we got over there. The other troops, the other people had been over there since probably the fall of 43, and they were taking a beating. They were really losing aircraft, and they were sorely needing us to fill in numbers wise. So ordinarily we would have received, I think in Dick's case, they got more training missions over there, And we just got a few and were thrust into the combat. We had to get in there and help these two other groups, so we didn't get too much training.
Which group were you assigned to?
398th.
How many missions did you fly?
I flew 31 actual missions. When I went over there, the number of missions you were to fly before being finished and sent back home was 25. Then shortly after that, they raised it to 30. This was all predicated upon how many what their losses were, I guess. It was 25, and they found that there wasn't too many crews were able to complete 25. So then it went to 30, and then it went to 35. Well, they prorated the number of missions you were to fly as to when you arrived over there. And so I flew 31 actual missions and then was credited for two more because of their having to fly 35. So in other words, paper-wise, I got credited for 33, but actually I flew 31.
But it amounted to a full tour.
Oh, yes, it was a full tour, yeah. I was fortunate to be able to fly a full tour.
And I should ask, you've been talking about your pilot. What was the name of your pilot?
I'm going to tell you, but I hesitate to say it because, sadly, after about 7, 8, 9 missions, he had to throw in the towel. I don't know how to express it otherwise. He couldn't take it. We're all different, you know, and he couldn't, he just couldn't take it.
Yeah.
We'd come down cold and everything, and his flying suit would be soaking wet from just mental anguish, I guess. And so after about 9 or 10 missions, he kind of threw in the towel, which was good for us because I could sense that he was having a problem and it wasn't good for the crew. But he was a West Pointer, and he went on probably to have an illustrious career afterwards, and I know he did because his wife, they were both very learned, and he became an authority, as well as his wife was an authority, on the Russian Air Force. I know this because I got publications after I retired on the Russian. They were officer-type magazines, and they'd have stories about the Russian Air Force and as far as their structure, and how they were built and what their organization was. And Harriet F. Scott, his wife, was the author. Can you imagine? His wife was that smart that she was an authority on the Russian Air Force. And they were advisors to people, the president, I think Nixon was in at the time, and so forth, and they were that important. So because he gave up, it was kind of I won't say disgraceful, but it was distasteful, put it that way. And you really want to know if I can tell you, but I admired the man for admitting that he couldn't take it and didn't jeopardize the rest of the crew.
You know, and that's an interesting point. You know, I'm going to ask you about missions in a minute, but these are extremely stressful, very, very stressful situations, and some men couldn't do it.
That's right.
Why were you able to do it? What was in your makeup and background that allowed you to survive it mentally?
Let me think. I appreciated being given the position I was in as a young kid. And I was a young 20 when I started out. I was 20, but I was a young 20 in the sense I'd never been away from home, hardly even overnight. And I was so proud of the fact that I was able to get through the program and get a pair of wings and become a second lieutenant. I wanted to prove myself. Not that I had to prove myself. I wasn't the kind of a kid had to prove that I was able and as good as the other boys I traveled with and so forth. But I wanted to show the results of my training. And I actually, I'm not bragging in the sense to say that I wasn't afraid of that first mission, afraid of what was going to happen. I was eagerly looking forward to it, actually.
Do you actually remember your first mission?
No, I don't. There I'm getting into areas of forgetfulness. And I remember flying and going out the airplane and flying, getting all prepared and so forth, but I don't remember much details about it.
You know, take us through, if you can, as best you remember, a typical mission. I mean, what would happen to, how would you even know you were going to fly a mission that day? And well, would they feed you? And what time did you get up? And, you know.
Yeah, well, as I say, there were three crews and one Nissen hut of officers. And if your crew was flying, they'd come around, seems to me like late in the afternoon or early evening of the day before the mission. Because you had to, you wouldn't want to be at the so-called officers club over there having a beer or drinking or something like that if you knew you were going to fly a mission. One thing, and along with that, one of the things that flight surgeon, who was always present at the briefings before takeoff, one question they'd ask us is if we'd had 5 hours sleep. Anyway, but we would be notified, say, late in the afternoon or early in the evening of the day before the mission by a CQ called Charge of Quarters, and he'd come around and tell which crew members were going to fly and which crew. And so then we might be wake up at, and they'd tell us what time briefing was. So we'd have to get up at, in a typical mission, as I'm saying, we might have to get up at 2 o'clock in the morning and get ready, get our gear together and go down to the mess hall and have breakfast maybe at, these are approximate times. We get up at 2, maybe we'd be down there eating at 3, maybe the briefing, we had to be in the briefing room, say, by 4, and we'd get in there and all assembled, sitting in chairs in the briefing room, and very shortly, there'd be somebody come on stage, a little bit of a stage up there, with curtains over the, like a movie, curtains over over the chart that was going to show the route and everything. And everybody's sitting there in anticipation of where we're going to go and everything. And finally somebody come up there with a baton, I guess you'd call it, or a pointer. And they draw the curtains apart, and there you saw the lines going on the chart to where you're going. Well, immediately there'd be, either was nothing, you'd hear nothing from the rest of us sitting out there, or stuff like this here. It was Berlin or Munich or an important target like that. And then we'd probably, the briefing wouldn't last much more than, the general briefing, much more than, say, a half an hour. And then there'd be specialized briefings for the pilots, the bombardiers, and then you all were, we'd all get on a 6x, a truck, or an army truck, and be driven to our aircraft. And the ground crew would already be there preparing the aircraft for flight. And we'd get our gear aboard and see if there's any flak suits in there, see that some other crew hadn't got there first and stole our, stole our flak suits. That was just something over across your chest and a flak helmet. And some of the crews there kind of laughable would try to get extra flak suits there to put on a suit put underneath them, you know, protecting what they hoped might be useful later on in life. And that's kind of funny, but that's the way it was. And anyway, that and then you'd wait for your for the takeoff. Tower would send up flares to let you know that was a go mission. I mean, the weather was such you're still going to go and everything. And you take off and turn. And then came one of the scariest parts of the whole mission. The scariest part was taking off, realized there's many bases all over England, and it's small compared to the number of bases. A lot of aircraft are taking off and going up through clouds and fog and everything. So this is the scariest part of the mission, was taking off through all this fogs and clouds and everything. And after you get out, after you get in the clear, trying to find your particular group and fly into the position you're supposed to be in. That'd be the lead and the aircraft that, on either side of the lead and so forth. And it was very, very difficult at times to find your own group, not talk of find what position you're in, your element and squadron, but just to get up there and find your own group. And that was so scary at times that I'd feel, as did many, I guess, that once you get in position and ready to go, you were formed up and ready to go to hit the channel and go, the mission was almost, was a good bit over for you. You really felt at ease. You didn't mind, I didn't mind going to the target or worry about getting to the target. You were there in position as a unit and ready to go. We did have mirror-to-air collisions over there during these assemblies. And anyway, going along with our story, that then you were in the air and on your way to the target. And
how would you occupy your time during this period? I mean, you're the bombardier, you're not at the target yet, so what are you doing?
As I say, I developed what I consider to be a good navigator as far as pilotage. I always had a chart in front of me. I just didn't sit there idling my time away or looking all around at the world or anything. I had a chart in front of me and helping the navigator as much as I could. And I was a good help to him. As we passed over town, I'd note we were 2 miles east of this place or so forth, and the time, that was important, because next time I gave him, told him where we were and marked the time, he could figure the distance where he had a little table over there, and he could figure the distance between the two, how much time it took us, and that gave him a ground speed, which he could use as an estimated time for arrival to the next point. And so I was a big help to him. And so I'd always have a chart on my knees there and keeping track of where we were. And I wish I was able to keep some of those charts there that I used, and had all those notations I made on them. I'd also, with these charts, I'd be making notation if we started receiving flak long before the target, which sometimes we did. I'd mark down where we received flak and where you could expect to have it again next mission, maybe, or help somebody else on another mission, tell them where you're going to get flak, probably, where the gun batteries were. So I kept myself occupied, and then reviewing the data for the bomb run and all that sort of stuff. I kept busy all the time. And
then how would it proceed? At some point, you're going to hit the IP.
Yeah. Okay, well, you could, of course, up to that point, you were, the navigator was navigating, and I was helping him as I could. We'd get up to the IP, the initial point, and then turn on the bomb run. And then as I heard Dick telling you, was straight and level flying then. You couldn't weave all around trying to dodge flak or fighters or anything. It would disrupt the whole group formation-wise. So it was straight in on flight then, no matter what you encountered, fighters or flak, you headed for the target, period.
Who's controlling the aircraft at this point?
From the IP on in, the IP might be long enough from the target that the navigator is still navigating. Or if I picked up the target, then through the bomb sight, I could fly the airplane, or the pilot could, through controls, I could fly the, I, when I made a correction with a tracking handle, I could control the aircraft. I'm tracking handle now. I'm bringing in B-52s. I don't want to do that. We didn't have a tracking handle on the B-17. But I could turn the aircraft with the bomb sight controls. Or if I turned a certain knob, course correction or something, it was also reflected up there on the pilot's instrument panel. And he could fly the airplane based upon the information I'm giving him just through controls on the bomb sight.
Is this the Norden bomb sight?
Norden bomb sight, yes. And so either he was controlling the aircraft or the bomb sight, I and the bomb sight were controlling the aircraft. And that was at the discretion of the pilot in weather, and whether we were in the midst of a lot of flak or fighters and stuff like that. The pilot would always make it was always his, at his discretion to, he was the commander.
Do you make the decision when to drop the bombs, or are you watching the lead plane?
Well, it was generally watching the lead plane. That was a discouraging thing for a lot of bombardiers that had done well in school and established a good circle error I was telling you about. We get over there, and as I say, I mentioned before that we were a West Point pilot, and we were kind of thrown in the background. The old timers there, the lead crews were picked and everything, cliques, if you want to call it cliques, just like in any organization. By gosh, you couldn't break into them. They were going to have the glory and the so forth and so on. And so we immediately started flying what we call tail end Charlie. And the only advantage of that was that with the vision I had there, I could see where the frack was bursting all around and so forth. And we could move a little bit in our position without destroying the rest of the formation, without hurting them. So, I got to the point where you after you've seen enough of this flak and you saw where it burst, you can almost tell where the next burst were going to be. Kind of follow the pattern. And I'd tell them, you better steer a little bit right or left or something like that. And we'd kind of dodge it, hopefully. So anyway...
So you had to follow the lead plane
as
far as when to drop the bombs.
Yeah, back to your question. There wasn't a situation where each bombardier synchronized himself, dropped the target. The lead aircraft sighted the target, hopefully, and dropped on it. And one bomb amongst his was always my goodness, I'm forgetting what to call it. You could see it drop, and it left the trail all the way down. There's a name for that bomb, and I can't think of it. But all the other bombardiers and the other ships would be trained on watching that lead ship. Smoke bomb, well, that's as good a description as any, I guess. It left the trail, smoke bomb. And anyway, when you saw him drop, everybody else dropped. And I guess they thought, the thought behind that was it would leave a good cluster on the ground, a good coverage. You know, and the group was supposed to be flying tucked in real close, all the aircraft, for our own protection against fighters, as well as forming a good pattern on the ground of bombs.
When the bombs dropped out of the plane, how did the plane react?
Well, it lifted a little bit. You could feel it when the load went. It lifted a little bit.
And then once the bombs are dropped, does everybody just sort of peel off, or do you stay in group?
No, stay right in formation. Mm-hmm. And hopefully the lead aircraft had a good bomb run, sighted the target properly, and had a good bomb run, because if you didn't, they'd have to make a 360-degree turn, and all the time you're getting shot at. This is something that nobody liked, because it put you in jeopardy twice as long as you should have been. You already completed the bomb run, but if it was missed or something, or some kind of difficulty, you had to go around again. And just stayed right in formation as best as possible. Of course, it'd break up a little about that time, taking turns as adept as the pilot was to keeping in his position. So it kind of, but that didn't happen too often. That didn't happen too often.
You know, talk about what, sir, somebody doesn't know what flak is. All right. What's that involved?
Well, it's these gun batteries on the ground would pick us up. And the flak was a shell, actually, an ammunition shell, and there were different sizes. There was 150s over there and 88s. There were different size shells, different size guns they were firing from. Well, they decided us, and they had pretty good equipment down there, plus the fact that we were generally leaving contrails. You've seen them in the sky, the white trail behind behind commercial airliners and everything else. Well, that was a good aid for them too, because they could see that, and they could see where they were bursting their flak, and they'd correct accordingly.
What did it look when you're in the airplane? You know, you're up there. What did it look like?
The flak. Yeah. Well, you wouldn't see it till naturally it burst, and it was a black puff, black white puff. And they were usually in a pattern of three or four puffs at one time. That's why I say riding in the back of the formation, well, looking ahead, seeing the way the flak was bursting, you can almost tell where the next was going to be. You developed a little technique of knowing where it was going to be.
How could you tell if it had hit the aircraft?
Oh, all right. Well, you didn't hear it hitting too much, except when you got in the ground, you saw all these flak holes. And my crew, fortunately, we were never knocked down, shot down, and we were never hit in a vulnerable spot where it made us abort the mission or get shot. Only one time we experienced when we got in the ground, we saw where a shell had gone through our right wing and toward the other part of the wing. And apparently it was not set to detonate on impact. It was probably set to detonate at a certain altitude, and it went right on through. And if it had burst on impact, we'd have lost a wing, and of course, that would have been the end of us. So we were fortunate that way. But it was very rare when you didn't come down when you had flak holes in the aircraft.
Sort of going back to our sort of generic mission, you drop the bombs, you stay in formation, you come around. Are you still getting hit with flak on the way back, usually?
Yes. Until you were far enough away from the target where the target wasn't protected, that particular target or city wasn't protected anymore by any aircraft batteries around it, where it wasn't deemed necessary. In other words, they didn't have them strung out all over Germany. They were just around the target area. So once you left the target area, you were pretty well free of flak. You know, then you had more than it was looking for fighters, because the fighters wouldn't get in a lot of that flak. They'd stay off till you get out of it. And speaking about flak, there's just one thing. I anticipated you're asking a question. What was one of the missions, one of the things you remember most about a mission, say? One thing that was on my mind right quick was really surprised me was Hamburg, Germany. It's a big town and a lot of waterways in there, docks and so forth. A very industrial town. Anyway, after we left the IP, I looked out there. There's a great big black cloud, and it wasn't a rain cloud. It was flak. And that the navigation problem was immediately solved. You just headed for that cloud of flak because that was where the target was. So that always stayed in my memory. It was, in other words, that was a lot of flak. It was really thick, and you had, if you can imagine, you had to fly through it. You knew you had to fly through it. So that was very memorable. On my third mission. The first mission, as you asked me before, I was eagerly looking forward to it. I really didn't have a fear of it, as probably a lot of the people did. But I got through that and got back and safe and sound and so forth. But the third mission was to Berlin. And as I said, we were thrust into combat very quickly. We didn't have too much training, and the third mission was Berlin. Well, when that curtain got pulled away that day in the briefing, there were very audible signs of gee whiz. And anyway, on that mission, our squadron commander, Major Gray, who was another West Pointer, a very beloved pilot, everybody liked him, his aircraft was hit and he keeled over, and that they were gone. I never saw any chutes or anything. Well, that made me realize, hey, we're really in a war. You know, this isn't a training mission. We're really in there. One of the first things I haven't forgotten was the anguish and realizing that this is serious business. Our squadron commander lost on my third mission. I don't know which one it might have been. Him might have been his first or second. I don't know, because they didn't fly every mission. And I thought, boy, this is something. The squadron commander's gone, and as well as 9 or 10 other people, how many were aboard that day, gone too. And as I say, I didn't see any chutes or anything, so I had to assume he was killed in action, I think. That was the final result. But it was something that really stuck in my mind. This is no game. Going to be lucky to get through this thing. Mm-hmm. And the percentages of getting through were low. But it didn't worry me. I thought, well, not that I was a braggart kind of a guy or anything, but I thought with my faith in God and so forth, and thought, I'm going to get through this thing. And he was gone. So anyway, then there was a lot of worrying, you might, not worrying, but anguish about the first part of those 31 missions. You kind of sweated them out, I should say, is probably a good expression. And then there came a period during the, and you got through them all right, weren't shot down or anything. There was a period during the middle portion of the missions where you developed not an attitude of they can't get me or something, but you eased up a little bit and you're thinking that we're going to get through this thing. And then you didn't start worrying again until the end when you only had only a few to go, and then you thought, gee, can I make it, you know?
All right, you know, and are you doing a countdown through this period? You know what I mean? Are you keeping track of the number of missions and
oh, yes. Yes, I wish I had some things like Dick had here, pictures and so forth. I took it upon myself. I found a big piece of cardboard, and I got something to draw, a pencil or something. I drew up the names of these officers on the three crews that slept in my hut, and I drew lines so I could put a date and so forth. And I kept track of the missions as to each individual in the hut there. I did it. And as a fruit mission, I'd put a bomb in the little square there. It meant we had flown that mission. And so I flew a couple of extra ones away from my crew. They needed a substitute in another airplane, and I flew it. So I achieved 31 missions before anybody in the hut did. And so somebody marked out there, by God, hero Taylor, you know, I got that. I got my missions first. And meanwhile, we lost a couple of them in there. We had replacements. That was always a sad thing.
You know, those occasions you flew with other crews, was that a little nerve-wracking to fly with unfamiliar?
Yes, it was. It was. Even though you knew what to expect and everybody did the same thing, in those days, we didn't fly exactly by a checklist, and everybody, as we did later on, and I won't get into that, but we became very professional later on, and you did everything as standard procedure. So if you went from one crew to another, then you knew exactly what was going to happen, when and where and so forth. But it wasn't that way in B-17s during the war. You didn't have time to achieve that degree of professionalism and dependence on the other members of the crew. You depended on them, but you didn't exactly know how they were going to react to certain situations.
At some point, I think it was the first 10 missions, you had a change in pilots.
Right? Yes, right. This West Point pilot, as I say, couldn't take it.
So who was the new pilot you got?
All right, we had a real good co-pilot, and I will say his name, Ernie Spitzer. He was a real good co-pilot, and we thought, well, there's no problem. We're all right. They'll put him in the pilot seat, which they probably would have. But poor Ernie had an appendix problem and had to go away for an appendix operation, so we didn't get him as our pilot. And so for a period, we didn't know what pilot we were going to have. Our crew would fly with it might be Jim Doe or Hank or somebody else. And by the same token, we were easy prey. Since we didn't have a regular assigned pilot and co-pilot, we were easy prey for if somebody couldn't fly on another crew, we were right there, you know, to say, hey, you're going to fly with this crew tomorrow and so forth. And that wasn't for the best for your nerves when you didn't know the people you were real well as far as their flying ability and how they'd react to situations like your own crew would. So that was a disadvantage our crew had by losing that pilot. It put us at a great disadvantage.
Was there a, you flew, I'm sure, a number of different aircraft, a number of different B-17s
yes.
in those 31 missions.
We didn't have our own aircraft. We never knew which one we were going to fly. There's a couple of missions that I had to, we didn't wear a backpack heavy parachute, the navigator and I, because moving around up there in the nose, so it was a chest pack hooked on two hooks, and it was rolled up, and there was two hooks on there, one underneath the side of your chest. There was a few times I had to go back in flight in the bomb bay. First of all, I had to go back there to pull the pins in the bombs. That's something the Bombardier had to do so that the bombs would be armed and not dropped safe. There were safety pins that had to be pulled, and you brought them back and showed them to the operations to show that you did go back and do it, and the bombs were going to be armed when they hit rather than safe. That was important. And if you didn't pull this pin, the pin went through a little propeller on the nose of the bomb or the tail, and which after release and the bomb got in the airstream, this little propeller would rotate and arm the weapon through the sequence in the bomb there. It would actually arm the weapon. So if you didn't pull a pin, that little propeller didn't go around, the bomb dropped, it's a dud. So anyway, we had to do that. Well, but what I'm getting at is there are a few missions where the bombs didn't drop from the shackle. The malfunction, obviously, a wire got entangled or something, the bomb didn't drop, so you'd have to go back there and do what you could to release them, kick them, do anything. And I've had to go back there and do that. That was kind of scary. You had that little chute on, as I say, the chest chute, and it was pretty narrow walking through the bomb bays anyway, due to the structure of the racks on either side of the catwalk. And and it was kind of scary to look. The bomb bay doors are open while you're doing this, and you try not to glance down, but long way down there, you know. But you had to get up there and kick them or shake them or do what you could to get rid of them, because you didn't want to bring them back.
When you flew your last mission, the 31st mission, did you know that was your last mission?
No, that's a good point to bring up. At that time, when I was credited for two more missions, that was on paper after we were all done, due to some regulation that said if you got over there at a certain point during the number of missions, 25, 30, or 35, they prorated, gave me credit for two missions that I actually didn't fly. But anybody asked me how many missions I flew, I don't say 33, I say 31, because I actually didn't fly it, but on my records it's 33. I never, so for that reason, I didn't know whether we had to, at that point when I was nearing the end of my missions, I didn't know whether I was going to fly 35 or what. So I came down, they said, you've flown your last mission. So I didn't experience all that fear, anguish, whatever you want to call it, of flying the last mission. That was great.
How long were you there before you headed home?
After the completion of the, it seems to me, not long at all. Not long at all. I don't mean to say like a week or 2 weeks or whatever, but it certainly wasn't more than, say, a couple of weeks.
And you said you came home on ship. Do you remember which ship it was?
Yes, SS Columbia. Oh. It wasn't like the Queen Mary or nothing like that. We came home and the submarines were still active in the Atlantic, and I was assigned to come home on this SS Columbia, and it was a merchant ship, very small. You could almost throw a baseball from one end to the other, quite small. Yet we were the flagship of the convoy. It was in a convoy. We were the flagship, and there were more German prisoners aboard then there were Americans, and we were down below, billeted down below, and they were on the deck most of the time, top deck, and they were very, very well dressed. They must have come from a place like Brest, France or something, where there was a garrison there. They were officers, and they had real fancy top coats and beautiful, beautiful clothing, beautiful uniforms. Anyway, they were on deck, and We, as Americans, we had our jacket on. Some of them had all their missions on the back, like Berlin and Leipzig and all these places, most of us were assigned a position, something to do on the trip back. I was assigned to the forward gun crew, and I'd help pass the ammunition, I might say. That was my job when we had a warning of submarine attacks. And to do so, I'd have to go up on the top deck and actually elbow my way through all these German prisoners on the top deck there. And it was kind of a scary feeling because there weren't that many American personnel on board, and the ship's crew was doing something else. And I always thought, I was always glad I got to the gun crew to start doing what I was supposed to do, because a few of them could have just grabbed a guy and threw him overboard, and nobody would have known it. So that's kind of scary, but that's the way it was. And every once in a while, you hear a loudspeaker, Nichtrauchen, no smoking, because we were subject to submarine attacks all the time. But
how did you spend the rest of the war then? After you got home, there was probably some leave, but then you had
I had to leave, and then like Dick, he went to Atlantic City too. I didn't know him then, but we were given about 30 days, put up in a hotel in Atlantic City, which was only about 60 miles away from Philadelphia, which was my residence then, where my parents lived. So that was kind of nice, being that close to home. Had about 30 days leave there, and to do whatever we wanted, and like Dick says, eat whatever you wanted, and it was great.
What was it like to see your parents?
They were really overjoyed and that I got through the war alive and everything. And I was there about 30 days and had my parents down there to visit me and so forth. And I was sent to Midland, Texas to Bombardier Instructor School and became an instructor. And got out several months later of my father being a good old truck driver. I said, take me down the local, Dad, and I'll sit in the right seat, like pilot and co-pilot. I'll sit in the right seat and be a helper, and that'll be my life. I'll start working and so forth. He's nothing doing. He only went the eighth grade, but he went to go to see me as a truck driver, and he said, nothing doing. You got a home here. You got a place to sleep and so forth, and you go to school, learn something, become something. So I did go to, only through him, he talked to me to go into school. So I went to college and got a degree, and I was going to be a CPA, all set to be a CPA when I got a call back because of Korea.
And how many years then were you in the service?
25 actually, but I'd been active in the reserves and earned points enough to give me 5 more years, 30. For retirement, that's the most you can accrue for retirement, 75% of your pay. So that was wonderful. That was a bonus.
What do you think about when you think about the young man you were? What pops in your head when you think back in those days back in England?
I enjoyed my stay over there mainly because I came from New England. From Portsmouth, and all the towns around me were Dover and Newmarket and Exeter, and all named after towns in England because there was a lot of English people settled there in New England. So when I think back, I enjoyed when I was over there meeting English people because I felt sort of a kinship with them. Probably, I don't know my name, Taylor, I don't know whether I must have been Scotch, Irish, or English, but anyway, they were the kind of people that I was used to in New England. And I loved to get out and eat their meals because they cooked the same kind of meals, simple meals, in where I came from at home as they do over there. And let me just say, I have fond thoughts of England because Dick and I went back there in '92, visited our old bases. That was a very memorable trip. We really had a lot of fun and met a lot of good people. And I just want to say too that I mentioned this group of men that we'd be having a drink with. Invariably, wherever I was, where there was a group like that, and you went to leave, there'd be an old man, a veteran, stick his hand out and say, hey, thanks for what you did. And that was worth a medal, just for somebody. They were very gracious people, and they knew what we did, you know. They knew we were flying B-17s and everything. They said, hey, thanks for what you did. And that was worth a medal.